When asked about the title for the fall ballet, Light and Shade, Michael Vernon, who's chairman of the IU Ballet Department, said he chose the ballets not only because of their look, but because of the ambiguity and the appropriateness of the title in terms of ballet. The two ballets that bookend the evening, Sweet Fields and Appalachian Spring, could not point out this contrast more clearly. Sweet Fields is almost luminous, light movements, all in white, bright and energetic. Appalachian Spring, on the other hand, is a darker, more somber piece, heavier in its movements, more intense in its storytelling, more urgent in the message it wants to communicate. The two pieces that fill out the middle of the evening are more abstract, but no less filled with contrasts and ambiguities. Eight easy pieces and eight more carry their own contrasts of light and shade, not the least of which is that the first is a ballet for women and the latter is a ballet for men. In the sense of light and shade, these ballets could represent the idea men are from Mars, women are from Venus. The first ballet of the evening is Sweet Fields, created by notable American choreographer Twyla Tharpe. It's a work that is at one and the same time playful and rigorous. American hymns, principally written by William Billings, taken from Shaker tradition, or based on the Sacred Harp hymnal, which is part of the shape note tradition of singing, supply the musical score. Shape note music, if you're not familiar with it, means that the notes are printed in special shapes that help the reader more easily identify them on the musical scale. The choreography comes directly from the atmosphere of the hymns, so much so that in keeping with 19th century American religious practice, most of the dances treat the women and the men as separate groups. It's only as the entire piece evolves that the dancers, six men and six women, begin to interact. Physically, the mood that these hymns suggest gets translated into a world of geometry. Diagonals, spirals, straight lines, circles. The goal is to use the movement of the dancers to give the hymns a physical life that expresses the meanings through movement rather than words. For example, in the sections of the Shaker hymns, the movements reflect the kind of gestures that were common in Shaker ritual. Although the patterns of the dance are highly sophisticated and continually are elaborating themselves through the piece, the driving force is always an expression of the simplicity and innocence of the 18th and 19th century. Sweet Fields is filled with light and filled with energy. Everything, the movement, the lighting, the costumes, which are all white, reflect the crisp, clean, pure character that are inspired by Tharpe's own Quaker background. The pure art of expressing the meaning that music inspires through movement is central to the next two ballets, Eight Easy Pieces and Eight More, both choreographed by Peter Martins, the current artistic director of the New York City Ballet. The first ballet, Eight Easy Pieces, is a series of eight very short dances choreographed for three women. It's based on short piano duets by Igor Stravinsky. The first three, originally called Three Easy Pieces, were written for friends. A march is dedicated to a fellow composer, Alfred Casella. A waltz is dedicated to Erik Satie. And there's a polka dedicated to Sergei Diaghilev, the impresario of the Ballet Russe. Actually, these pieces were made for the dedicatees to play, but Diaghilev was not much of a piano player, so Stravinsky made the easy part of the polka particularly easy, figuring that even Diaghilev could probably negotiate it. The second set of five duets, which followed a year later, were written for his children, Stravinsky's children. They include an andante, an espanola, a balalaika, a napolitana, and a galop. Eight More, which Martins choreographed as a companion piece 5 years later, uses almost the same music, except that now it's in the form of two suites for small orchestra that Stravinsky wrote based on the original Eight Easy Pieces. Fitting the thicker, heavier sound of an orchestra instead of a piano, Martins choreographed this work for three male dancers. Both pieces, when seen together, although each one is only 12 minutes long, provide an interesting opportunity to see how, using the same musical inspiration, ideas can change when thinking about applying them to men versus women. When seen as they are as part of this fall ballet program, they also make a compliment and comment on the ideas presented in Sweet Fields about separation and differing modes of expression. The final piece in the program, Light and Shade, is Appalachian Spring. It was created by Martha Graham with music by Aaron Copland almost 40 years before Eight Easy Pieces and more than 50 years before Sweet Fields. Appalachian Spring was written in a much darker time, when the United States was in the midst of the Second World War. So while it has a much different structure, for one thing, it's based on a definite storyline rather than abstract ideas, it equally concerns itself with the relationships between men and women and between them and the society as a group. The ballet does this by telling a story set in 19th century rural Pennsylvania. It looks at the social and religious interactions of a frontier community. At least the version that the world has come to know tells this story, although it didn't start that way. Earlier versions included a showboat kind of stage and a Civil War story. The original idea for the ballet was commissioned by Elizabeth Coolidge, who is more notably known for having founded the Berkshire Festival at Tanglewood. Graham approached Copland with her story, but he was reluctant to collaborate with her since he felt it was too dark and heavy. By the time the actual commission for Copland to compose the music was settled, by the way, the original commission was for the extravagant amount of $500, the story had changed to Pennsylvania and become more about life on what Graham thought of as the frontier. Not that Copland knew much more about the story than the basic outline, such as moods that Graham wanted to create, and some timings. For example, she would say, tender section, 2 minutes long. In addition, until very late in the process, Graham had also thought to include spoken quotations from the Bible. Fortunately, I think, Graham realized that dance could embody the ideas she wanted to communicate in a much more powerful and pure way, rather than relying on literal quotations. The work was in such a state of evolution that it didn't even have a title. To Copland, it was simply known as A Ballet from Arthur. The actual naming of the work took place just before its premiere in 1944, when Graham, who was inspired by a poem by Hart Crane, the American poet, arrived at the idea of calling it Appalachian Spring. His poem is in praise of the mountains and a spring, as in water, that flowed through them. The music itself was intended to feel genuinely American and direct in its simplicity, a style, by the way, that would come to be associated with all of Copland's compositions. For this reason, just as Twyla Tharp would do 50 years later, Shaker Hymns, specifically in Appalachian Spring, Simple Gifts is the hymn, form much of the thematic material. In Appalachian Spring, 6 of its 14 sections are based on that one tune. Considering how atmospheric subsequent critics have thought of Copland's music for the ballet, it's really interesting to remember that at the time he was writing it, he had no idea what he was writing for. As he himself put it years later, "I gave voice to that region without knowing I was giving voice to it." So it was so successful a voice that in 1945 he was awarded the Pulitzer Prize for his music. Regardless of how the piece got its name, or the music used, or any of the other details of its creation, the undeniable fact is that it's a masterpiece of the art of dance. It represents the very best that can happen when movement and music combine. It tells a tale of American life, which expresses hope and energy that are the essence of the American spirit. It spoke strongly and clearly to its own generation, and has continued to do so, not only to generation of Americans, but to the entire world ever since. For IU Ballet Theater, I'm Vince Liotta.